Before there was Jack Parr, there was my guest, the man who created and hosted The Tonight Show, comedian, musician, author, Steve Areno. Steve Allen is with us tonight. And then later on, whether it's insider trading or a paternity suit, he's the man to call, a top white-collar defense lawyer who has answered the call of clients such as Johnny Carson, Covenant House founder Father Bruce Ritter, and Revlon chairman Ron Perlman. Stanley Arkin, great attorney, is going to join us tonight and talk about the law, all coming straight up on Straightforward. Author of some 45 books, composer of 5,300 songs, 31 of which he's going to perform tonight on our show. I could either spend the next 25 minutes giving you his credits, or I can talk with this prolific, witty American original, Steve Allen. Steve, nice to see you.
Nice to be seen, Roger, as I always say in response to that cue.
I want to get this up right away. This guy, how do you write so many books? I know, guys, I've been working on a book. It's 7 years now.
Really?
Yeah, I'm on chapter two.
Some masterpieces have taken that long. I do it all with my mouth into this little thing, any tape recorder. I haven't typed a story in many years.
Really? So you just dictated your... Now, yeah. What if you have a couple of days off? Can you go back and remember where you were, or do you start dictating?
No. After I dictate it, then, of course, it gets typed.
Right.
And on the third day, then I'm just a regular editor of my own copy. And if I haven't finished something in the first sitting, then I just look at page 14 and take it from there.
That's amazing. Look at the books. We'll put them on the screen right now. This is one called, what is it called? The Man Who Turned Back the Clock.
Collection of short stories.
Short stories by Steve Allen. Short stories are kind of hard to write, I think. I tried once. I couldn't.
Really?
It was so short. It was very short.
I find them easier than novels, if only because they could be 23 pages, whereas a novel could be 400. But I wish that there was some connection between the quality of the ultimate work and the ease or difficulty with which one writes, but I don't think there is.
Do you have a publisher? You just call them up and say, okay, I got another one ready. I mean, they must feel like they've got a Steve Allen factory somewhere that keeps shipping new stuff.
Because I write so many different kinds of things, no one publisher would be interested. There's a house called Prometheus, which brings out the short stories and some of my, quote, weightier works, in which I generally attempt literature or important social commentary. And then a company called Kensington brings out these light murder mysteries that I do for them.
This one. This is called Murder on the Atlantic. Is this where you and Jane are sort of the stars? And
yes. It's a little bit like the old William Powell, Myrna Loy,
Thin Man series.
We get in trouble, we unmask the murderer in the last chapter, and they're fun.
Steve, I have often told people, because I've produced television for 30 years, as you know, and
you
people
produced
say,
one of my series.
I did. I produced, I think we did a bunch of comedy specials one summer.
Called Laugh Back, yeah.
Laugh Back, yeah. And people have said to me, who was the best? Because I worked with an awful lot of the talk show hosts. And mm-hmm. I said, look, everybody in the business took from Steve Allen. Everybody learned it. Isn't that, I mean, you did things that nobody else did in those days.
At least I did them first. Everybody does them now.
Yeah.
But I'd like to ask you a question. Are you embarrassed when you are complimented to your face? I'm serious.
I am, but I often repeat the, and I get over it by repeating it frequently. I am. Do you still?
Yeah, I wouldn't say I'd rather be insulted, but I can handle it and say, hey, you stink. That's okay. Good luck to you. But when people come up and tell you how...
No, I'll tell you, you're the greatest, because I remember that old show you had down at Hollywood and Vine or whatever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, jumping in the Jell-O and doing stuff that nobody ever did. And yet, there was an intelligence to your conversation. I remember you could have a scientist on or something and have... Mm-hmm. Where did you decide you could do comedy at the same time you could do serious stuff and make it work?
That's a marvelous question. The answer is I have decided very little in my life. A lot has happened to me, for better or worse. But whatever I do now, and I'm now in my 70s, I was doing it on a more modest level from the time I was 12, 14, 15. I never went to versatility school or decided not to do any one thing for a living. But in school, I was playing the piano with the school dance bands and writing poems for the school magazine and jokes for the school newspaper and short stories and that sort of thing. And I just kept to that pattern.
My favorite stuff was often Man on the Street and the things you did with Louis Nye and Tom Poston and those kind of things. And then the Real Man on the Street, where you went out and got...
With the camera,
The camera.
Yeah.
I think we have a clip, don't we, from the... let's take a look at this Man on the Street, Steve Allen. I don't know what circa this, what year we were here, but we'll roll it and we'll take a look at it.
All right.
Do you vote for presidency in this country, sir?
I do.
Good. If a person running for president was an acknowledged heterosexual, would that matter to you?
It would.
Well, how would you would not vote for him or her?
I wouldn't vote for him or her.
Just because they're a heterosexual?
Yeah.
Simple question. if a person, seriously now, running for the presidency of the United States, revealed that he was an admitted heterosexual, in all honesty, could you vote for him or her?
No.
No. It's, you know, what's you did things like that, though, that people don't listen.
Yeah.
They don't, or did they not know what the word meant? No, they would have if they'd have stopped to think about it, perhaps.
If they saw it in a book, they probably could figure it out, but they were nervous with the camera and then me in their face with a microphone. The one who used to do a lot of that marvelous stuff was Candid Camera.
Yeah, sure.
Well, I certainly forgot
Alan Funt.
Alan Funt, yeah. He often would employ the obscure word, although that's not a very obscure one, device. And if people were more honest, they would say, Chief, forgive me, but I don't know what heterosexual means. But they never will own up to that.
No, they will never own up to it. I remember once somebody, and it might have been you, but they asked people, they'd stop people and say, do you have scruples?
Yeah, that was one of Alan Funt's
Was
routines.
That Alan Funt? Yeah. And they'd say, no, because they thought it was a social disease. And so they'd say, no, absolutely not. I've never had scruples. Mm-hmm. And it's a great game to play with people.
Yeah, I love to engage real people in real conversations. No, well, that happened to be cut down. In the original, we didn't edit it. We just showed what we did.
Right. Did videotape hurt comedy in these kinds of shows?
I honestly don't think so. It didn't affect the way I worked because I was always loose and spontaneous. What videotape does, as you know, as a producer, it enables you to throw away the little sections that didn't work.
Yeah, so in that sense, miss the timing. You can tighten the timing up and make it work.
But maybe for the people at home, there's a little less excitement if they realize this was taped a month ago. But I don't know. I think the shows are often better for tape.
Does a guy who does what you do for a living, this may seem like an odd question. Do you have to like people, or I mean, is that important, or are you able just to walk up to strangers and have a conversation, but you don't have to care?
A marvelous question. I find myself fumbling for an answer. I think it helps if you like people, and by and large, I do. If somebody comes up and spits in my face, we're not immediately bosom buddies, but that's never happened, come to think of it. And when I'm doing comedy, it doesn't matter.
It really doesn't matter.
Whether I would invite that person home to dinner or not. At the moment, I'm looking for laughs. I will never be cruel to them. I'll never, because those are cheap, easy laughs, and too many of them in the world now. But I guess it's an irrelevant consideration.
How do you feel about comedy or so-called comedy that a Howard Stern does, for instance, reaches for a taste, which is, there's a niche there. I always say there's a niche of people who have bad taste.
With all due respect to Howard Stern, who certainly is a human being and therefore deserves our our affection as such, I don't think what he does is comedy. The laughs he get are what, as you know, are called shock laughs. People are laughing at the vulgarity, at the obscenity, I didn't see his special, but I saw a picture in a magazine. The man came in sitting on a toilet with his pants down. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's comedy.
No.
It's just trying to shock people, and it sure is shocking. Mm-hmm. And he's become rich doing that. So
how would you have handled the situation the other night on Jay Leno? Did you read about it?
No.
He went on Jay Leno with two women clad in bikinis, and asked them to engage in a lesbian kiss on the air. And Jay Leno said, look, this isn't right, and then he put one over his knee and was spanking her, and they ended up cutting out a half of the tape. And Jay sort of said, you know, he was kind of apologetic. How would you handle that? I don't know how you handle that.
Well, unless you're in that ballgame, you don't know exactly what you would do. I would certainly, if I were in his part, I would certainly express my disapproval. As a matter of fact, I was talking to somebody in the last couple of days about something I saw Jack Parr do a year or so ago when Jay Leno was visiting New York, took the show to New York for a week. And Jack did, a surprise walk-on. He was only on stage for a minute or two. He said, Jay, I can't stay. I just wanted to welcome you to New York. And he got a big ovation because we hadn't seen him in some time. And then they turned, the two of them looked at the old desk and the old chairs. And Jack said, my goodness, in effect, when I think of all the important people of our century who have sat in these chairs on your show and mine and Johnny's and so forth, and he was talking about Eleanor Roosevelt
Jack Kennedy, many.
Yeah, giant names. And he pointed to the chair right next to the desk, and he said, and they sat in that chair, and he put his hand on Jay's arm, and he said, Jay, do me a favor. Please, never let Madonna sit in that chair. I sent him a fan letter about
that. That's amazing.
It was a way of making a statement about the incredible vulgarity of so much television these days.
Have we torn down important people so there aren't too many left? I mean, I sometimes think we sort of trample our heroes and then wonder why there aren't any.
A good point. Of course, heroes are always constructed with feet of clay simply because they're humans. There are a few people who have been designated as saints, but you can get them all on one school bus, I guess. I mean, there never have been many, no matter what faith lists them. And the rest of us are all in one kind of moral trouble or another. But the emphasis now on meanness and scandal and gossip, because again, there's money in it. If you can turn a buck, you can turn a buck selling, well, I won't even use the language, and you can, you know, then people are going to shovel it out. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about the weakness of human nature itself. I think it was Bertrand Russell who said, man has never yet refused to employ any device that became available to him, no matter to what evil ends it could be put.
Steve Allen, we're going to be right back. Here he is, author, musician. He's going to play for us a little later, too, some of the things that he's written. This is one of his books, Murder on the Atlantic. We'll be right back with Steve Allen.
Or else you're alone and then you suddenly dig. You're looking in someone's eyes. You suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big. You're lunching at 21 and watching your diet. Declining a Charlotte Russe, accepting a fig. When out of a clear blue sky, it's suddenly gallon guy. And this could be the start of something big.
Welcome back, folks. We're talking with a man who needs no introduction. He wants one, but he doesn't need one. Steve, that letters to the editor thing, where'd you come up with that? I mean, that was
drawn from the journalistic staple supply. As you know, newspapers have been doing that for about 200 years. There's an important question, should the king divorce Catherine, or whatever the question is. Right. And they send a photographer out, and they talk to three or four people, take their pictures. So I was just making fun of that journalistic staple. But we lucked out. We got wonderfully funny guys to play those parts. Don Knotts, Tom Poston, Louis Nye, Bill Dana, Pat Harrington, Gabe Dell, and the rest. So it was always funny.
Do you think America is all right in terms of their sense of humor, or have we lost it? Political correctness taking some of it away from us?
I don't think so. You could approach the problem numerically. In the 1950s, I remember this because I wrote a piece for the Atlantic Monthly at their request, there were only, believe it or not now, about 50 comedians in show business, and most people couldn't have named 30 of them. Now there are about 5,000, so there's no shortage of funny people.
There are still 50 working, though.
Well, actually, there's a lot of work now for a lot of comics. They're bringing them into the sitcoms. They finally figured out that it's better to get a funny person and give them funny material than to get a former movie star and try to make them funny.
Mm-hmm. You never did a sitcom, did you?
No, we were offered, Jane and I were offered a number. She's doing one right now. It's the new show called High Society on CBS. Eventually, we might try one, but we haven't done it yet.
Tony, my producer, said that you had a cameo in Casino.
Yes, cameo indeed. Very quick scene, but it was fun doing it. I love Martin Scorsese's films. Who doesn't? And it was an honor to be invited to jump in.
We've got some phone calls here, and I want to come back to talk again about the short story book in a second. But Steve, okay, in New York. Steve, you're on the line with Steve.
Yes, hi, Steve. I don't want to embarrass you, but I do have to compliment you. I've been a fan of yours since the 50s, I guess, and I think you were the great innovator in television. I think most of what David Letterman does comes out of your show. And
by the way, he's dropping in the ratings now. So
that'll teach him.
That'll teach him to steal.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Steve.
Steve, yeah, did you have a question for Mr. Allen?
I did. Well, actually, you just started to touch on your movie career and having a cameo in Casino. Mm-hmm. But I was wondering, I remember you in the Benny Goodman story.
Great.
And I just wondered, whatever, did you decide at some point that films were not the medium for you? And
thanks, Steve. That's a great question. Actually, yeah, let me ask you about that, because you were so good and your acting was so good.
Yeah,
and most guys who do what you do, talk for a living, don't necessarily
also comedians sometimes have trouble scraping the funny off, but I didn't, so I acted totally straight in that movie. Actually, if you draw back and look at the, let's say, the list of 15 people, Johnny Carson, Jack Parr, Arthur Godfrey, Dave Garraway, in that category, very few of us did movies. We all did two or three, but we were busy doing television, and I do 19 things already. I'm sorry I couldn't do 20.
Mm-hmm. You know, great men often are remembered for only one thing.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Mahatma Gandhi, and he had a sheet, and he sat in a road. I mean, there were things that they did. Each guy did a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Churchill had cigars and won the war. Whatever they did.
Yeah.
You've done so much. Are you worried that you're going to people are going to try to remember why they should remember you?
Well, it's a marvelous question. I even if I were worried about it, I couldn't do anything about it.
Did Jane ever say, Steve, you're doing too much?
No. I have a funny answer to that, but it's vulgar. This pattern is genetically imposed on me, I guess. When I was 10 or 12, as I mentioned earlier, I was doing all these same things. And if you can do 1, 14, 29 things, whatever it is, there's no reason to stop doing three of them. You know.
Now, I've been a student of yours for many, many years. I think I read somewhere that your parents had an alcohol problem. Is that true? And if so, did that cause you to have a sense of humor? Did that force you to kind of compensate?
Another great question. My mother has been called by Milton Berle the funniest woman in vaudeville. She was a vaudeville entertainer. My father played straight, singer, nice guy. I don't think he was that funny. But the Donahues, my mother's family, were all funny. They were a crazy Irish, witty, sarcastic, and slightly cuckoo group. So whether it rubbed off by living with them or it was partly genetic, there's no way to determine. I think gifts generally are primarily genetic. You can have a family with 10 kids. Only one of them is a good violin player. So they all were exposed to the same cultural influences, but only one had this mysterious gift.
We have a show on our network called Parenting, because I know you've raised kids, it's my theory that if we solve the parenting problem, we're going to solve a lot of social problems down the road.
You're quite right.
Is there something in your studies or reading or whatever that is a model for people in terms of raising children? What is it that a kid needs, and how do you make sure he doesn't end up in the state pen?
You got about 3 hours? I'm serious.
It's one of those kinds of things.
Yeah, there's so much to it. You can't just say, take them out to a movie Saturday night. You have to be there a lot more than you think you do. I'm brilliant about this now, but now I'm in my 70s. My kids are grown up. When I was 20, I wasn't that hip to what I should do. I meant well. I loved them.
Do you believe the term quality time?
Yes, but even if you're just sitting watching some dumb show, that's better than no time at all. Uh-huh. Too many kids are alone these days, and if they get lonesome at house because dad's not there or mom's not there or grandma's not there, they'll go out in the street and we know what's going on out there. So you've opened a very important question here, and congratulations on your own efforts to do that show.
Yeah, we're trying to get into this in our show on Parents Helper. You mentioned what's going on the street. I want to talk to you about crime, because that's another issue that I think you know something about. You know, it's amazing that you know so much about. Why didn't you ever run for political office?
I was encouraged to, but I thought it over, and I can have more influence and swing a looser bat working alone. They tried to get me in California to run for office, and I guess I would have done a fair job, but I decided not to.
You'd have been much too funny for those guys. I mean, we laugh at them, but not for the same kind of reasons. We'll have some more questions for Steve Allen when we come back. If you have one, give us a call, 1-800-988-TALK.
February 2nd in Chicago, hometown of Benny Goodman, still the king to legions of fans.
Well, folks, when you have a baby grand on the set and you have Steve Allen as a guest, you don't have to be P.T. Barnum to figure out what to do. Ladies and gentlemen, the musical side of my guest, Mr. Steve Allen.
Thank you, Roger. People are always asking composers, what have you written lately? So here's something I wrote the other day. It doesn't even have a title yet. It's a ballad.
One hand clapping, but it's only me and the crew, so we do it anyway.
It's embarrassing to get an ovation from three people, but that's all right.
Well, at least our heart's in the right place.
Yes.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
What did you do? figure out the melody line and then go back and fill it in, or do you just write linearly?
Yeah, it all occurs in one big clump.
Really?
The melody, a note doesn't mean much unless you add harmonic coloration to it. And anyway, it all comes together. Some of it is even in dreams. I dream melodies.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Do you hum in bed? I mean, when you sleep, I mean, you work it out?
Again, I have a funny answer to that, which will edit out. Ding, ding, ding. I censor myself. No, seriously, my best-known song called This Could Be the Start of Something occurred in a dream. And I wrote the score a few years ago for Alice in Wonderland, the CBS musical. And what I think is the prettiest melody in that show occurred in a dream. So I may be more talented asleep than awake. I don't know.
We have a phone. I wasn't going to take a phone call here, but we've got a lady calling from Alabama. Martha, you're on the line with Steve Allen. Go ahead.
Hi, Mr. Allen. How are you tonight?
Fine, dear.
Go ahead.
I was just wondering, you and your gorgeous wife have had a long, happy marriage. What are your secrets for your long, happy marriage?
Never go to bed mad. We have our arguments, as everybody does, but just, you know, don't go to bed mad. We were up once for 3 months, I admit that, but rimshot on that joke, folks.
Yes, I know.
Thank you, dear.
No, you did you did something about maintaining relationships, though, didn't you? Didn't you write, or have you lectured on it, or you and your wife?
Well, but Jane and I sometimes speak on it. I don't have a single act as a comic, and very often people bring up this subject matter, so I'll talk about anything they bring up.
There must be more to it than that, because Dave Barry, who writes amusing things, said that, you know, whenever I feel like making love to a woman, I find a woman I don't like and give her my house, because I know that's how it's going to end up.
He's wonderfully witty. Yeah.
In maintaining a relationship, though, more than don't go to bed mad. Does that mean talk a lot, talk it out, or what?
Yeah,
does it mean?
I could also say you want to be married a long time, marry Jane Meadows, but she's already spoken for. She's incredibly bright. In fact, her brain is brighter than her mouth sometimes. It works so fast, she sometimes says odd things. And that helps a lot, because at least we understand each other. I don't think we will ever totally understand each other.
Steve, to do the things you do and have the talent you have to be sensitive. If she... does she say things that hurt your feelings, or
yes,
say, you know, I really hate that song, or...
She never says anything of that sort, no, but sometimes, partly because of her high intelligence, she's a little impatient, but I can't complain, because so am I. I
really?
Think people who think fast...
Say things and then...
Yeah, often, you want the book to be placed here, and if they don't put it here, you say, now why the hell didn't you place it there? I told you to Tuesday, you know.
Right, yeah. And
we both do that.
Yep. This book, a short story in here... you told me about it in the break, and I lost the card. Tell me about
that. The day the Jews disappeared.
Yeah, the Jews disappeared. Tell me about that story.
Well, of all the 31 stories, it's the one that seems to be getting the most feedback. It's a science fiction story, fortunately. And in the story, America wakes up one morning, and there are no Jews anywhere in the country, and they later find out anywhere in the world. And then the story simply more or less logically develops what might, in fact, happen were such a cataclysmic thing to occur. And, of course, the point of the story is anti-Semitism is pretty stupid. If a given Jew hits you on the head with a stick, go ahead and don't like him. But because he hits you on the head with a stick, don't apply your hatred to 80 million people.
It's a marvelous concept, because, in fact, that's what Hitler tried to do, didn't he? I mean, he tried to make the Jews disappear.
Yeah. There are levels to that story. So, and it was reprinted just the other day in the B'nai B'rith Messenger, so it's being well received.
An interesting concept, and
it
probably ought to be read in schools, because it's that line from South Pacific, they have to be carefully taught. Most people don't dislike each other on sight.
Yeah.
They have to be told to dislike each other.
Yeah. And even sometimes if you visit the camp of, quote, the enemy, with or without the quotes, I discovered that when I visited China and the Soviet Union back during the days when we weren't as civilized with each other as we are now. And even there, I found that I liked individuals. I hated communism. I hated what they were suffering through, but I liked them personally.
Right.
And that's really the way it should be.
Yeah. Let me go back to politics just for one second. Are you optimistic about the way the country's going, or pessimistic? Or do you go in and out of that phase, depending?
I oscillate between pessimism and optimism, as I think we all do. If I had to come down on one side of the question or the other, I'm about 57% pessimistic. We're going to have to make a lot of changes to halt the slide into the sewer.
If you were president and I woke up tomorrow morning and they said... President Allen, what would you like us to concentrate on today?
One of the first things I would do is add a fourth R to the traditional three, and the fourth would be reasoning. I argued this a few years ago in a book of mine called Dumpth about the collapse of intelligence in our country. We are going to have to be taught, starting from kindergarten, I argue, to reason. Everybody thinks like they know how to breathe, they know how to think. No, they do know how to breathe, they don't know how to think. They do a little thinking, and the very bright ones tend to do it rather well, but they're about 1% of us. And the rest of us urgently need explanations of the difference between consistent evidence and conclusive evidence. The subtitle of my book was dumped on 81 Ways to Make Americans Smarter. I'm not here to selling it tonight. It's out of print and it's in libraries.
Was that the one that said, there was a phrase that everybody says incorrectly that drives me nuts and drove you nuts, too. It was something
I could care less.
Couldn't care less or could care less. That was
The correct version, of course, is I couldn't care less.
I couldn't care less.
And now it's more often that one hears, I could care less, which doesn't even mean anything, folks. Stop that.
Yeah. That's something we have in common. That phrase makes me nuts. Mm-hmm. You've worked with Steve Lawrence, Edie Gourmet, a lot, right?
Yeah. From the old Tonight Show days.
Good friends and all that. They've had a successful marriage all these years, too, right?
Yes, they have. And as you know, a lot of people in the entertainment world have. But the reason nobody ever says, Flash, Bob Hope is still married, you never publicize good news.
Could you, are you good enough friends, like, if you're mad at Jane, could you say, look, I'm going to bed, I'm not mad at Edie? I mean, could you, like, trade off and just say...
That's a funny question. Yeah, Jane and I sometimes do. I think it's important for all young marrieds or people who are going to get married next week to know that any two people argue. They don't have to be husbands and wives. They could run a meat market in Bucharest together. They will differ on important points and sometimes get heated and angry about it. But if you want to keep the relationship together, business, marriage, fishing buddies, whatever it is, you have to learn to climb over the anger. But there's a terrible satisfaction to anger, especially when it's at its peak. Mm-hmm. Oh, damn it, I'm going to show those, you know. Uh-huh. And you feel real manly, and you're going to fix up the world. Yeah. And then in the morning, you wake up, and you're sorry. You know,
it's a dumb... Don't fool yourself.
Don't let anger rule you. It's a dumb leader.
Tell me about the song you're going to do for us to wrap it up tonight.
Well, if I can remember the word, I'll do about 16 bars, because I don't want to slow down your show. But tomorrow night...
No, that's all right. We're okay.
In L.A., we're doing a big dinner, the Society of Singers, honoring our dear friend, Steve and Edie. And I'll be doing this song. Steve and Edie, there they are. Who'd have thought they'd come this far? Seems like only yesterday he met her. Both too young to have a past. People said it wouldn't last. Seems like only yesterday they married. Who knows when love will come along? And who can say that a love will stay when so many go wrong? Steve and Edie. And it goes on like that.
Ah, that's wonderful. Steve, got to wrap it up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Roger. It was a pleasure.
Buy his books. Let me tell you something about this. I've been around the business a long time. This guy's an original. And they are very few and far between. I'm not going to say any more of that because he doesn't like it when he gets complimented in person. He gets very shy. Books, songs, plays, inventions. Good luck on all of them. Cures for whatever ails you. And my best to Jane. Good to see you. Take us to break.
Thanks,
we'll
Rich.
Be back in just a second with one of the country's foremost white-collar criminal defense attorneys, Stanley Arkin. Stay with us.